created all things. O God, who stretch forth your mighty hand. This morning, oh, we invoke your holy presence. Blessed Father in heaven, come into this place, I pray, dear God. Riding on the four winds of the evening, blessed Jesus, and sanctify and bless us, Lord. Peace be within these walls, O God, and prosperity within these palaces. We need you, blessed Jesus. For we need you, blessed Lord. What a friend we have in Jesus. We bring it before you, blessed Lord. Every situation in our lives, we bring it before you, blessed Jesus. For we know you're mighty to save and strong to deliver. Touch us, blessed Lord. Touch the speaker, blessed Jesus. Touch every church, every child. Help us to continue to do thy will in spirit and in truth. When we are weak, O God, make us strong. Darkness, dear Lord, let your healer. Sadness, joy, blessed Jesus. Sickness, now a speedy recovery. Take our lives and let it be. Consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take now the moments and days. With the flowing ceaseless praise.
So, Yeah. Jesus, we come before you, Lord. Father, we come to give you praise, honor, and glory, O God. Father, to thank you, O Lord, for sparing our lives to see this day, O God. Father, to thank you, Lord, for a good night's rest, O God. Oh, Father, Lord, to thank you for the air that we breathe, oh God. Father, to thank you for you providing the meal for us as the day come and go, oh God. Father, the clothing and the transport, oh God. Father, Lord, we just want to thank you this morning, oh God. Father, to give you all the praise and glory, oh God. Father, Lord, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, this morning, oh God. Father, for he came here without sin, oh God. Father, Lord, to be a pain and tribulation for us, oh God. Almighty and ever-wise God, this morning, oh God. Father, we thank you for the love that you have shed for us, oh God. Oh, blessed Lamb of Calvary, this morning. Father, bring all those that gather this morning, oh God. Father, bring all those that came here in your name, oh God. Father, Lord, all those that come this morning, oh Lord. Father, grant them a blessing this morning, oh God. Father, speak to them in dreams and vision, oh God. Father, direct their path this morning, oh God. Almighty and ever-wise God, oh Lord. Oh, blessed Lamb of Calvary. Look at every church this morning, oh God. Father, wherever they are this morning, oh God. Father, Lord, invite them closer and closer to you, oh God. Father, Lord, put peace, love, and unity, oh God. Father, put understanding in the churches today, oh God. Almighty God, this morning, let them all come together as one, oh God. Father, to be like a heaven of stick that shall never be removed, oh God. Oh, blessed Lamb of Calvary, look at the youths, oh God. Look at the young ones that are about to come, oh God. Almighty God, direct their path, oh God. Father, instill your word in them, oh God. Father, instill your love in them, oh God. Oh, blessed Lamb of Calvary, this morning, I thank you for those that born and open the meeting, oh Lord.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from all evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen and amen. Yeah.
I see something on the flyer that says, though I wear it well, doesn't mean that it's heaven. Oh Lord. Does that mean that it's not heaven? And my thoughts start traveling. And I remember a man who was wearing humility well. And because he wore it well, they took counsel against him. And they took him to a place where they call the judgment hall, whereby he can be tested. And this man they took him to said, I am fighting for this man. Because this man realized this man wearing humility well. For a closer walk with a common heavenly friend, we can have a light to shine upon the road, Lord. To shine upon the road, Lord. Answer the question. And somewhere along the line said he didn't answer either. And the powers that be said, don't you know I have power to crucify thee and to release thee? And in humility he said, you have no power over me except in the what? Given from. We may not know, we can. Hello, what pain we have to bear, Lord. What pain we have. We believe it was for us, Lord.
Oh,
one verse of this hymn. I'm going to take my seat, amen. How sweet
Bishop Janet, Dr. Janet or the Janet. You beautiful saints in Christ, United Holy Revival, one in the corner there. God bless you, God bless you. Did I crack down there? A nice hairstyle, well done. God bless you. Did I run, God bless you. Aaron and the crew over there. Teacher Jillian and the crew here. God bless you. Teacher Anne Marie and Sister Deborah here. And my good friend from Trinidad. New vision here. God bless, God bless. Did I leave out anyone? What about Michael? Sorry, Paul. House of Esther Divine Ministry. St. Mary's Bishop Knight, my good Panamanian affair. Yeah, good Panamanian affair. God bless you for coming. God bless all of you. God bless you. Yes, Leader Roger, God bless you. Thank you for coming. Jesus. And the photographer, God bless you. God bless you. And the moderator. We are getting ready. Sister Diane and her beautiful daughter, Kelly Elliott. Stop. We are getting ready to go into the Word. Huh? The Word, the Word, the Word. The Bible said the Word will make flesh on earth. This young man that will break bread with us this evening. I pray that we listen. Don't worry about it. The food, you have more than enough. Right? So, but we want to get enough of the spiritual food to keep us. So that if you would stand to your feet, this young man need no big reading from paper. He get bachelor's. He's a hero. I don't have to say all of that. But I must just present to someone in the truth to the Bible. The man that the great bread with us this evening. Bishop Joker and I let's try to. Bishop Fatima. He's a Baptist. A real Baptist. Not a fly by the Baptist. A real Baptist. He just gets spiritual. Oh, you know what?
Don't tell him.
But he will break bread with us. But if you just sing one stanza with me, this well-known hymn, we will call it, some of us call it the anthem of the spiritual Baptist. O God of heaven, in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter from the storm blast, and all eternal hope. And after singing that, we're going to elevate our hands so that God will bless the young man. Self will be crucified. The devil will be horrified. And God will be glorified. All right? Amen. Oh God!
Trouble ye her. She had brought a good word on me. For ye have the poor with you always, and whensoever you will, you may do good to them, but me you have not always. She had done what she could. She had done what she could. She has come aforehand to anoint my body to marry. Verily I say unto you, wheresoever this gospel shall be preached throughout the whole world, this also that she hath done shall be spoken of for a memorial of her. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And we bless God for the reading of his holy word. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I like to be in order. And so when I was given the topic, I made a few phone calls and I asked for a scripture to go along with the theme, because sometimes people have their own scriptures, amen? The teacher Laura decided that she said that she wanted me to dig, amen? Amen. And so I am blessed to be here today to give you what I got from this, amen. The theme today is just because I carry it well doesn't mean it isn't heavy, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Does anyone in here have a witness in your spirit when you hear this word? Just because. I smile sometimes just because. I laugh sometimes just because. Even become the life of the party, amen, somebody. But just because I carry it well doesn't mean it's not heavy, amen.
Amen.
Amen. This poem, praise God, was made famous by a Christian author, a Christian blogger. Her name is Christine Lewis, amen. And she made this quote because she said she wanted to explore life in grace and not in chaos, amen. It is strange sometimes that sometimes you might find some of the most powerful words that will help you through life, not in church, but outside of church. Amen, somebody. You just never know where God is going to bless you. Amen. You just never know who God is going to send your way with one gracious word. Amen. And that's why the Bible says, entertain strangers, because unaware, you might be entertaining an angel. Amen. We have all at some point in time dealt with or currently dealing with personal issues. Am I the only one in here? I know you're being saved on today, but can you confess that you're dealing with some issues? I know you dressed up real nice today, but can somebody confess I'm dealing with some issues? I know you can pray. A lack of transparency is what's killing the church, because we don't want to be transparent and say, even though I might preach well, even though I might sing well, even though I might dance well, sometimes I still hurt. Hallelujah, somebody. Your it might be different from my it. And my it might be different from their it. But one thing that we all have in common is that we are all dealing with this it. Amen, somebody. We are all dealing with something that we don't know how to communicate to somebody else. We are dealing with something that we're not too proud of. We're dealing with something that hurts. But you gotta carry it well. You can't retaliate, praise God, somebody. You can't act up, amen. Because that's what the devil is waiting for you to act up has stirred up many memories of past hurt for some folks. This quote has stirred up memories of some of the most loneliest times for some folk. You might be saying, what you mean, loneliest times? I'm around a bunch of people, I'm not lonely, I have a million friends, I'm not lonely, I have numbers in my phone, I'm not lonely. But how many of us can be truthful and say, even though I have all these numbers in my book, I'm still lonely? I can be in a crowd and I'm still lonely because nobody hears the cry that's on the inside of me. Nobody understands that even though I'm laughing inside, I'm dying. I can be in a house full of people and I'm still lonely. Oh, praise God, somebody. I hope I didn't come to the deep church today. I hope I came to the church that will talk back to me today. Can you confess that even though you might have the best of the best, you still go through lonely? You have a big house, but you don't have nobody in it. You're lonely. Have a nice car, but don't nobody want to drive in your car. You're still lonely. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? Hallelujah. Some of us, they don't know what it's like.
Amen.
This talk has become a voice for some people that are dealing with some situations that until you and I actually walk in that situation, we don't have no business judging them. Some of us, we let our mouths judge what we have never walked, what we have never entertained, what we have never dealt with. We pass judgment. But you don't know the pain that it took for me to go to bed last night. You don't understand the pain that it took for me to wake up this morning. I'm dealing with depression. I'm dealing with anxiety. I don't want to go to work, but I realize that if I don't go to work, I ain't gonna have no money, and I gotta pay bills. So I gotta push myself up out of this bed and get to the place that I hate the most. People are dealing with issues.
Yeah.
But where can in a bad movie script? Pay your tithes, pay your offering, you do the fast, you buy the head tithes, you support everybody else's venture, but somehow, when it's your turn, it seems like you're always lacking. Do I have a witness in here? It seems like you're always ready to help somebody, but when you heavy. This quotation, no matter how in the church today, it seems like if kindness is a rare commodity, it's like a precious ointment that few people want to buy. Hello, somebody. It seems like in the church today, kindness is something that we really, really act. We might preach on it, but there's a difference between preaching and living what you're preaching. How many of us know you can preach a good part, but if your boss don't line up with your boss? It seems like if the church affords kindness to certain people, by certain people, and if you're not in that clique, if you're not in that clan, if you're not in that group, if you're not in that, like the older people will say, you see someone operating under pressure and they don't ask for help, doesn't mean they don't feel the pressure. Not because you see someone doing the very best that they can and you know that you are in a position to help them, but you have pride on your side. You have somebody in your ear telling you don't help them because this and that, and I heard this and that, and you're waiting for that person to crack, but it's something that God knows how to give you in perfect peace. And even when you're going through the storm, and you're going through the valley, and you're going through the rough path, God will make sure you don't buckle, that you don't break. You don't buckle.
Oh, yes.
It's something about a lump of coal and some pressure. See, when people look at you, sometimes they don't treat you good. Sometimes if you have a certain title before your name, they don't treat you good. Sometimes if you don't have a certain somebody in your corner, they don't treat you good. But tell somebody, I might be a lump of coal for you, but I'm under pressure right now. I want to understand about pressure. When pressure is applied to a lump of coal, it turns in to the most fierce of diamonds. Tell somebody, don't look at me now. Wait until you see when God is finished with me. Oh, Lord, carry it well. It's not heaven.
That's right. All right.
It's something when people leave you for dead, brother. You don't need that some spiritual morticians. When they love to walk around with screwdrivers and nails and hammers, and they like to pronounce your death even before you hit the tomb, but tell them that you have a relationship with the resurrector. You know somebody that will be with you.
Told it was the place where you were supposed to receive your healing, but
there is something else that we carry, leader God.
Go ahead.
That has some weight.
Yes. Yes.
There is something else that we possess that has some weight.
Yes.
And so getting to the first half of this scripture, starting at verse 3, it says, and being in Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at meat, there came a woman. Now, I want to give my apologies to Bible scholars that are in here. We know that he is referring to Mary, amen? But for the sake of just dealing with the text, the way that the text is presented, it said, there came a woman. No name was given to her, hello somebody. No title wasn't given to her, hello somebody. All it says is that there came this woman. Sometimes you can enter a place and don't nobody want to recognize you. Don't nobody want to celebrate you. They will call everybody else's name. But when they get to your name, they begin to stammer. They begin to sigh. They begin to say, oh my God, a woman, nobody's going to want to want to.
You want to bind up the strong man
says that this was the second supper now at Simon the leper's home. Jesus always made it his business to be with the outcasts of society.
Yeah.
I find it strange that we say that Jesus is our greatest example, yet still we are the only people that will collectively embarrass somebody else because they don't look like you, they don't smell like you, they don't dress like you, they don't believe what you believe. Your job is not to convince them. Your job is just to be a light, a bright picture, make your light it shine.
Amen. Amen.
Sometimes a little kindness can go a long way. A little kindness can open up doors for you that may or rather be shut in your face. Sometimes a little kindness will speak for you in places where you're not able to speak for yourself. You see, because where you can't show up, the story behind your character shows up and they say, well, we still gotta make room for one more because she's been at every prayer breakfast. In the first clause of the third verse is that there came a woman. In Mark's gospel, she remains nameless. You know, it is a hurtful thing to respect everybody, call them by the name that you know them, but when it comes time for them to address you, somehow, manifestation take over, ringing bell take over, anything to make sure that they don't call your name, but tell somebody there's a purpose why you remain the unknown. There's a glory behind this story. The Bible says this unknown woman came in to the house of Simon the leper. She came into a house that she wasn't invited to. She came and she crashed the party that she didn't have an invitation for. You better tell somebody wherever Jesus is, you'll find me there. Invitation or no invitation, when I'm not there. Yes, sometimes God will cause you to be unknown until the work that he has started in you is finished. You see, because the reality is, some of us, you call them friends. Some of us, you call them spiritual family. But some of you are surrounded by some people that if they really know your potential, if they really know your value, if they really know your worth, if they really know who you are, they will try to frustrate your purpose to go ahead and make you the unknown until he finished what he started in you. Sometimes God will hide you in plain sight. You're standing up right there, but they cannot see you. Let me tell you what that is. That is when the Spirit of God has moved you from one vibration to another vibration, and they are on a lower vibration. But those on a lower vibration can never see what is on a higher vibration. you didn't do anything wrong, but God changed. God moved you. And so those that are not on your level, they will stand next to you and they will even recognize it was you standing next to them until you make yourself known. I've been standing here all the time and they said, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know. The devil is a liar. God is hiding me. He's finishing his purpose in me. And until he finishes, I am going to remain unknown. Amen, somebody. Specializes in hiding you in plain sight because it's the cost of the oil. You gotta realize that that oil costs you something. We all say, Lord, let me be. God, make me this. God, do for this and I will do that. But there is a price that you have to pay to possess the oil that was in that box. I come to talk to just a few people today. I come to talk to just a few people today that can say, I know what it costs. I have to live on bread and butter alone just to make sure that I have enough money to pay my rent. I want to talk to some people today that can say all I had was water in my refrigerator, but I had to make a choice. Pay the church rent or let the church door close. And I made a decision. If God raised it to me, he's going to make a way for me. So I sacrificed my house to keep the doors of the church open. And you can tell nobody.
Oh yeah.
It wasn't your post on social media. You know, some of us, we look for internet fame. And we jump onto social media to advertise how humble we are. But if I got to advertise how humble I am, then I'm really not humble. Because humbleness is not something that I say out my mouth. Humbleness is what so the Bible says, this woman, don't get her name. This woman, she came having an alabaster box of ointment, spikenard, very precious. This ointment is made from a flower that grows only in the Himalayas in India. Oh, so magnificent. I want you to gaze with your spiritual eyes. This flower that they're gonna dry and then crush for oil only grows in India. The alabaster box is made from a rare stone, which at that time was only found in Egypt. When God is working on you, he will move you from one nation to another nation to pick up knowledge and understanding. But it is up to you to understand the value of what is being shown or given to you. Some of us, we go up to the morning ground and we tell our stories about how many things that we've gotten. She was learned. She didn't have no name, but she had the anointing. Hello, somebody. Tell somebody, you may not know my name, but I got the anointing. You may not know my name, but I got salvation. You may not know my name, but I got favor. This woman that had no name had the anointing with her. She said, I got to get this precious oil one way or another.
Woo! Oh, yes. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
What are you willing to do for the oil? What are you willing to do for the oil? Follow the taste of the oil. What are you willing to give up for the oil? Bible talks about the five wise and the five foolish virgins. Bible says that the five wise, they came with just enough oil for them in the lamp. And when the bridegroom came, they were able to go and receive him. But the five foolish, when they brought their empty lamp, they said, can you give us some of the oil that is in your lamp? But the five foolish said, I brought just enough for me. You didn't pay the price that I paid. You didn't suffer what I suffer. You didn't go through what I go through. So you can possess my anointing. What is the use of having a lamp with no oil?
Ouch.
If you come from Gonzales, you know what kerosene is.
Aye, aye, aye.
The Bible says was more than 300 pence. was more than a year's earnings. This unknown woman sacrificed much to acquire just a little bit of the oil. But when Pastor asked you to come out, you have every excuse why you can't come out. Every excuse why you can't give tithe and offering. Every excuse why you can't help the church build and fund. Every excuse why the money should stay in your pocket and not in the house of God. But let somebody bring out a new shoe, a new pad, a new car, a new hair, a new this, a new weave. You find money to get it. Your priorities are mixed up. You will sacrifice for things that you will die and leave here.
Somebody touch me. Somebody touch me, hallelujah!
Our priorities are screwed up. When we would take rent money to buy our costume for Labor Day, but when the pastor say, can you sacrifice one money paycheck, one rent paycheck to have the doors of the church stay open, you begin to tell the pastor that if you can't keep the door open, then God didn't give it to you. But you would take that same rent money and buy a costume and put yourself in a picture closet. The devil is a liar. You got to find your priorities. We sacrifice to the wrong thing and to the wrong people.
Yes, I have
a
book
as
money. Bible says she broke the box. Understand what she did. She broke the box because it was an Eastern custom that when a dignitary came into your home and they drank from a glass, that after they finished drinking from that glass, you break the glass because nobody else is worthy to drink from that glass. I suggest to you that when Mary broke that box, she said, I'm breaking this box so nobody can reuse it for their own purpose. What I'm pouring out all of me on all of him.
Glory.
Bible says, she poured the contents on his head. And then there was some that had indignation within themselves. Bible says, every time you desire to do good, evil is always. Maybe you can help me. She came into the house. She didn't take food. She didn't take drink. She didn't ask to turn the music down. She didn't ask for water. She went to the master that was in the midst of the disciples, and she anointed him, and they called her stupid for that. They called her wasteful for that. They said that she's trying to make a mockery. She's trying to show up herself. She's trying to prove more than what she really is. And then one of them had the nerve to say she would have done better if she had taken that oil and sold it and given it to the poor. Let me help you understand this. You gotta understand, brothers and sisters, that the oil that you carry is so precious, so pure, so potent, that when you pour it out as a sacrifice of worship, when you pour it out as a garment of praise, that oil will expose those that came They were upset.
Yes, Lord.
Because she poured oil on the master. They said it was a waste. But Jesus said it was worship.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Can I just bend over your head? They poured the oil a waste, but Jesus called it worship. That's the word we hear. We need to speak. Mothers, you're doing the best that you can. But there are some spiritual children, no matter what you do, how you teach them, they're going to do exactly what they want to do. But don't you dare throw in the towel. It is not a waste. You're giving them the anointing. It's up to them to make it last. Amen, somebody. Let me talk to the preachers. Preachers, sometimes you will preach out of the belly of your soul, and they will look at you as if you're not saying nothing, but you got to preach until God says it's time to switch. Amen, somebody. You got to realize you can't let nobody or nothing look the anointing out of you, make you drop your praise, make you drop your worship, make you drop your word of faith. You got to be in the place where you say, for God I live and for God I die. This unknown woman, she didn't have to care what they said about her. She said, I came to pour. She said, you won't dare the night that Jesus saved me. Within her spirit, she says, you won't dare to see the tears that I cry. Let me tell you something about the life of a worshiper. The life of a worshiper is a life that is a remorseful praise for God. The life of a worshiper is someone that knows that God can make it even when folks are not in your corner. But when you are a worshiper, you don't look for worship. You give worship. The disciples that sat in that room, they looked at her and they said, why is she anointing him? They tried to discredit who Jesus really was. And you better be mindful of there's some people that will try to discredit who you are without knowing how much you have grown in the spirit. And they call themselves your friends. But I want you to understand what just happened. The disciple says, why would you base the oil on him? But you have been following him for how many years? You have had him preach to you. You saw him heal. You saw him have the blind recover. You saw the deaf receive their hearing. You saw spirits obey him. And yet you have the nerve to ask, why would you waste your oil on the master? There are some people that are so bold-faced in ministry. They want you to praise God higher than they will praise God. But you cannot show up your praise to pacify somebody else. You better praise God, and if your life depends on it, praise God, and if you have value. They had the audacity to discredit Jesus to his face. Let me talk to the church. Don't count it strange when the same people that you helped will come and discredit you to your face. If they did it to Jesus, chances are they're gonna do it to you. The same people that you had to give money to when nobody else could give them money. The same people you have to lend bread to, you have
came from.
That was just sitting down spectating.
have something to see.
Yes.
Yes. I've learned that I don't let spectators dictate my worship.
Hallelujah. Yes.
I don't let spectators dictate my praise. You see, because you wasn't there when God had to work it out for me.
Yes, Lord.
And now He is deserving of every praise that will ever escape out of my mouth. The statement was made by a waste. Jesus said, let her go. Why are you troubling her? She has done a good work for me. For you have the poor with you always. And whenever you feel like it, you might do a little feeding. He said, but me, you don't have always. She had done what she could. Now I'll be truthful with you guys. I have read that scripture a few times, past and present. And it never stuck out to me, those words. She did what she could.
Yes.
Understand the beauty. Christ is saying that she poured everything. Gave everything. Anointed him with everything. And you have the audacity to call it a waste way. But you sit with your hands in your pocket on a Sunday, and if they call you to say the words, you have a this, you can't be with you. You left your glasses home, and they ask you to say a prayer, and you know where I'm going, I make a call, and they ask you to greet the people, and you have a reason, I don't like shit, I don't, I'm going to put me there. But I heard somebody say, I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord. Let me close on this note. Finally, what did it for this woman? She exemplified humility. Humility will carry you into places that you never thought that you would ever be. When you are humble, it's not something you do with your face. It's something you do with your actions. Can I talk to the church? When you are humble, you don't have to convince anybody else that you are humble. You arrive at a place where if they say, sit right here by the door, you say, thank you very much, I sit. And you have the biggest smile. Because I didn't come for name recognition. I came to give God some praise. I came to pour the oil that was in this alabaster box. I came to give him my garment of worship. Holy. Teach your grace. can leave broken. A wise man will go in one way and come out another way. So if you walk into the church and your disposition is that of sadness, when you are finished having your encounter with God, you are a worshiper, and every time I see you, I get more depressed. The devil is a liar. Is there a worshiper in here today that can praise God, that Lord, that can confidence? It will change when you praise God. The holiness will change when you praise God. The posture will change. Tell somebody, it will go. I tell you now, it's a I'm
Behold how good and how blessed setting is. Brethren, dwell together in unity. God bless you, God keep you, God make his face to shine upon you in all the men.
High the Lord at earth and here at sky. This afternoon, dear Lord God, we give you glory, honor, and praise. We adore you for whom you are, Lord God. You are God all by yourself. Father Jesus, this afternoon, as we are gathered here to praise and magnify your holy name, dear Lord Jesus, we invite your presence here. We thank you, Father God, for making yourself known among us this day. My God, as my assignment is to call upon thee for the elders of the church this afternoon. Mighty God, you know each and every one by their name, title. This evening, Father God, I bring every elder of the churches before you, bishops, archbishops, pastors, leaders, shepherds, whatever the title is of this, our dear God. We bring them before your mercy, Father Jesus. And as the title is today, Father God, we dress ourselves daily carrying the load. And so we thank you, Father God, for allowing us and giving us the strength, Father God, to pull to your people. Help us this afternoon, Father God, that as you give us wisdom, knowledge, and understanding to lead your flock, Father God, and we'll do it with a heart of conviction, with a heart that is pure, Father Jesus, that when we call them to the throne of grace and take them to baptism, Lord God, that we do not think that we own them, but that they are your children, Father God. Help us, Father, as the brother said, to humble ourselves and to set ourselves aside, Father Jesus, and hear from you, dear Lord, before we make any moves. My God, this afternoon, we pray. Every elder, Father God. We thank you for the strength that you have given us. We thank you, dear Lord God, for providing for us. We thank you for the open doors that the church is receiving. My God, we pray, Lord God, day and night for those who we are looking after, dear Lord Jesus. But we know the word of assurance that in return there will be some that are praying our strength, my God. Help us this evening, Father God, to cover each other. Under the blood of Jesus, that you will give us, God, the strength to go on, the strength to pursue, the strength, oh God, to go forward. My God, this evening, Father Jesus, those here, Lord God, who are falling along the way, help us, Lord, to lift them up and to bring them forth, dear Lord, back to the place where they were, that they may worship and honor you and glorify your name. Lord God, let us not take your glory, but that we may continue
Father God, that we, O God, would be filled, Lord God,
Hallelujah. Father, these blessings and mercies I ask, God, upon the new river of God, in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise be to God. Sister Olivia, church, church, sister Olivia.
Praise the Lord. Ready? A lifetime in a... Oh, God. Can we never see you?
Oh,